Joined by Tanea Gumake, Ramona Shelburne, and Kendrick Perkins is going to be beaming in momentarily.
Beaming in.
And everyone have a good weekend?
Oh, great weekend.
Great weekend. You got your
trick or treat. Halloweening.
Yeah.
With Daniel. Little ones. Yeah.
What was adorable. Nanny?
He was a little piggy.
Oh, my gosh. I love it. All right. Diving into the NBA today, Ramona, you have an update on Joel Embiid. What can you tell us?
Well, he's going to sit out of tonight's game against the Portland Trailblazers. They're calling it rest. They have a couple of back-to-backs in the next 7 days. But over the weekend, he did have an MRI on that troublesome right knee that has been bothering him pretty much since the beginning of the season when he knocked knees with Jonas Valanciunas. That MRI came back clean. There's nothing to be concerned about. But that knee has bothered him, and that's why they got the MRI, because it wasn't getting worse, but it wasn't necessarily getting better either. Yeah. So it's something he just has to manage, because it's not the kind of thing that you can do anything about in the middle of the season.
Got it. So clean MRI for Joel Embiid, but he's resting in their game tonight. Thank you, Ramona. So more news in the East this morning. Kevin Love, according to The Athletic, is expected to miss several games in the league's coronavirus health and safety protocols. So let's take a look at the rest of the conference now and go coast to coast on the best of October, starting with the best in the East. So four teams are 5-1. That is the Knicks, the Wizards, the Bulls, and the Heat. And if I said that 2 months ago, I'm not sure y'all would.
I'm sure Perk will say that he
said that. He would. Yeah. And then let's go west. The Warriors and the Jazz are also 5-1, and Utah has the best point differential in the conference, outscoring opponents by nearly 13 points per game. And one of the biggest surprises thus far, you see them there, it's the Hornets are scoring over 118 points per game, best in the league after finishing 23rd last season. So those were the best teams. Now let's look at the best players thus far, starting with Steph Curry and Ja Morant, because they are the top scorers. And Rudy Gobert leads in rebounds, Chris Paul in assists, and Al Horford in blocks.
Okay.
Paul George.
Didn't see that one coming.
Steals, I know, right?
Yeah,
so quickly, Chinee, who is your biggest winner in October?
Surprisingly, the Washington Wizards at 5-1.
Yeah.
I would have never guessed that, especially after Russell Westbrook leaves. That's a big hole. No matter how you try to say, like, oh, his game is good or bad or however it works, this team has picked up and they've done an amazing job. Bradley Beal and Spencer Dinwiddie. I mean, Spencer has been a great backcourt mate for Bradley, who was, you know, always been top of the, you know, points per game standings. Kyle Kuzma knows what it's like to be a role player. Montrezl Harrell is playing like a dog.
Mm.
Big kudos to Coach Wes Unseld, because he's been able to revamp that team in a way that they're playing fundamental basketball on both ends. And he's been that strong voice in the room that makes them feel like all they have to go out there and do is play textbook basketball.
So John Wall turned into Russell Westbrook, who turned into the core of a pretty nice team so far.
Good addition.
Yeah,
Stanford.
I'm going to go with the Miami Heat.
Okay.
I mean,
all right,
look, it's a bit of a recency effect. Okay, but we all summer long, what do we talk about? They're going to have a great defense, but I don't know how they're going to score. They're scoring, and they're scoring because Kyle Lowry is pushing the ball. 23 fast break points for their starters per 48 minutes. When you don't have a guy who can go for 35 every night, you push the ball and you create offense that way. And, Kyle is not necessarily averaging a ton of points right now. He's dealing with a little elbow issue, but he's pushing the ball and getting them out and running.
There are a lot of really good hustle stats from this team. Let's textbook Miami Heat. But, like, if you look at a night where Bam Adebayo can really spearhead an offensive rebounding 17 that turns into 31 points, they're playing basketball the harder way, but the more effective way.
So the Wizards and the Heat, one team that we didn't mention that we were talking a whole lot about at the beginning of the season, are the Brooklyn Nets, and they're the East favorites entering October. The Nets tried to find their footing against the Pistons last night. Did a little bit. So James Harden, the Nets, hosting the Pistons. Second quarter, the Nets are up 6. Harden, guarded by Isaiah Stewart. Harden, in his bag, takes a little step back. You know that's good. Later then, in the second quarter, the Nets are up by 9. Harden, double-teamed, passed it to Blake Griffin. Blake Griffin looks like he's going to pass, but then he shoots it in midair. Look at this. It looks like he changes his mind.
Hold up. Wait a minute.
And he says, I'm going to shoot that thing.
Well, hang on.
Yeah.
Yes. That was finished? No.
And he made it look easy. All right. Less than 3 minutes left in the second. Harden throws a pass ahead to Kevin Durant, who does what he does. Harden finished with 11 points, 6 rebounds, and 7 assists in the first half. So in the third quarter, Nets up 17. Watch Durant here. He comes up. He looks like he's trying to fight through a screen, but he gets that elbow up a little bit high. Hits Kelly Olynyk.
That's not a little high.
That's a lot high.
Like elbow.
Well, the referees agreed, and he gets a flagrant 2 foul and is ejected. He finished with 23 points. So closing seconds of the third, Harden drives, lunges to DeAndre Bembry. Harden had 18 points, 10 rebounds, 12 assists. It was his first triple-double of the year, ladies. 117-91, Nets win it.
I think the confidence and just my rhythm and all that's coming back, you know, simultaneously together. And it's just, it feels much, much better. I kind of knew that I was going to have a slow start just because I wasn't, you know, playing a lot. I knew the work was going to catch up and ultimately I was going to get back to where I needed to be. Game by game, I'm just more confident, extra pep in my step, just overall, you know, much better.
So James Harden struggled getting to the line in the first five games of the season, only averaging 3 free throw attempts per game. But in these last two games, he got to the line 22 times, and the rest of his game opened up, increasing his numbers across the board. So, Chinee, how have you seen Harden flip the switch?
I love it because we saw it in one game when he shot 19 free throws. Yep. And let's go to the board. Why don't you guys come with me so I can break it all down.
Break it down.
What I really love about James Harden is that he walks the walk and he doesn't talk the talk. He'll let his game speak volumes. So give me the tape, producer Jesse, today. This is what he was dealing with the beginning of the season. A lot of contact, drawing fouls, and getting up. He's a very durable player with the exception of last year. And he took all of that angst and everyone saying, is he okay, and all that type of stuff, and he translated it to his game. Look at how many defenders are always hanging on him, and he's realized ever since that 19 free throw game, he's got to lock in, whether it's getting to the paint, finishing at the rim like we saw all the time in Houston, or saucing on the perimeter. James Harden, first triple-double of the year, is largely because he's flipped the switch, because he heard everyone talking about him saying, you need to be more aggressive. And when he was aggressive, what was aggressive?
He said beat.
What happened?
Aggressive.
The Nets looks beat. So beat. Much better, aggressive. You know what I'm saying?
I love it. All right, so Ramona, Harden previously mentioned how hard it was for him to train this summer following that hamstring injury. What have you heard about his route back, as Kendrick Perkins is also going to be joining
us? Well, he was rusty, right, coming into this, because he was not able to play basketball over the summer. He spent so much time just rehabilitating that hamstring injury. He had 2 grade 2 hamstring pulls. Okay, that is a serious injury, just one of them. He came back to have another one.
Right.
He had spent all summer just working on the hamstring. And I know you have the social media jokes, right? He was out with little babies, a fashion week. He was working hard to just rehab that hamstring. But his game, as Chinee says, has so much finesse to it, has so much touch. Like, he's such a good shooter and such a crafty player. He just needed a little time to play his way back into shape here.
Absolutely. And he said that he wasn't really able to do all that much.
I feel like
at
we
all.
Saw this movie before last year.
Right. And I'm hoping, is this going to be the sequel? That's kind of what we're gonna have to see. I promise Kendrick Perkins. Kendrick Perkins is joining us now. So, Perk, we saw KD also get ejected in that highlight. He threw a ball into the stands on Friday night. It earned him a $25,000 fine. What, if anything, do you make of these instances?
You know what? It's hard to say for the simple fact that, you know, the game that he threw the ball in the stands, they actually won the game. And then even the game that he got ejected, they were up by double digits and were actually playing good basketball. So I don't want to say that KD was frustrated. I just think that, you know, he just have, you know, it's emotions, right? And I don't know what's going through his head. I think a lot of us really don't know at times what's going through Kevin Durant's head, right? So I don't want to make assumptions. But, you know, at the end of the day, I'm not used to seeing this KD. He's more physical. I don't know if, you know, the Kyrie Irving situation is taking a toll with his frustration or whatever it may be. But, you know, at the end of the day, I still can't figure it out. They were winning the basketball games. They won the games. Like, I don't understand the throwing of the ball in the stands.
Yeah.
Well, Kirk, the Olynyk play, don't you think, though? Like, I mean, Kelly kind of gets into it with people. Like, that's sort of his game.
He does.
Yeah, I mean, I could see that, but KD didn't seem way worse. Like, you know, like, just think about it. Battling with P.J. Tucker, it doesn't get any worse than that, right? He didn't battle with P.J. Tucker throughout the series. It's nothing that Kelly Olynyk could do to frustrate him. Like, you know, I just don't know. I can't really tell.
Well, I do know a little bit, my brother Perk. I do think that this emotional reaction right now, what are they, 2-3 or so on the season? I think that a lot of people have been talking about their team. And KD, I'm actually happy that he has shown a little, you know, energy emotionally. But, like, make sure everybody's safe, whether it's a player, Kelly Olynyk, or the fan. You got to make sure everyone's safe. But, like, you saw at the end of my breakdown, James Harden flexing and emotional. That is very rare. These are two guys that are typically methodical and almost robotic when they play the game. And I think that that's a lot of the pressure that they're hearing, and they're trying to turn that pressure into performance, which they have. That sometimes, you know, when your coach gets ejected, it galvanizes people.
And you're raising the roof. They were able to win those two games, as Kendrick Perkins mentioned. And then Kevin Durant said, you know, I was really just trying to fight through the screen. And looking back on the replay, it was a little physical. He also, ref said he should have been ejected when he threw that ball into the stands when they looked back at the replay. So those were two instances that could have gone differently than they did. But hey, what do they say? At the end of the day, winning.